Well, speaking of being over, we thought the Stanley Cup Finals could have been over last night. We thought it could have been over a few nights ago in Edmonton. But what has happened? Well, the Edmonton Oilers have come alive. All of a sudden, a potential sweep has become a 3-1 series. And then in Florida, with a Stanley Cup celebration on the way, it becomes a 3-2 series.
Uh-oh.
Best player on earth, Connor McDavid's heating up. And now, with everything on the line, the series heads back 8 hours to Edmonton's loud-ass barn, and this thing could be staring down a Game 7. Ladies and gentlemen, joining us is a man who played in the NHL and is playing in the NHL for 17 years thus far.
Damn.
He's a Stanley Cup champion. He's also the brother-in-law of A.J. Hawk. Ladies and gentlemen, Jack Johnson.
Yay, Jackie!
How you doing, Jack?
I'm doing great, guys. How you doing?
Hey, thank you for joining us. I see... Hey. Oh, hey. I got a little Lordo here, too.
Wow, matching.
You know what I mean? It's like we kind of look like we're in the same exact backdrop. I appreciate that. Congrats, Stanley Cup champ, Jack Johnson.
Yeah.
There you go. All right, Jack, let's talk about this Stanley Cup series here. Thought it was going to be a sweep. A lot of people on the outside looking in. For you hockey people, did you know that it was inevitable that the Edmonton Oilers and Connor McDavid and this team that is so talented would fight back and extend this series? Or did you worry a little bit about this maybe being quick work for the Florida Panthers as well, Jack?
Well, I mean, obviously, once it gets to 3-0, there's that possibility. But I was a little surprised it got to 3-0, beating the Stanley Cup Finals with that kind of firepower that Edmonton has. I mean, they got some high-end talent. They got as much high-end talent as anybody in the league that can throw at you. They've been living on their power play for so long, going at an incredible rate. That has started to pick up lately. And at the end of the day, in the playoffs, it's hard to beat a team four times. And winning that fourth one is tough, let alone in the Stanley Cup Finals. You know the cup's in the building. You know, last night in Florida at home, from my own experience, there's a lot going on there for those guys. I mean, each person probably had 20 people that flew in to see him, family. People are telling them about, you know, where the parties are going to be after parties. And in the meantime, you still got to win a Stanley Cup Final game. And you know how hard it's going to be. So sometimes the best thing for a team is to get on the road when you have a chance to clinch and kind of hunker down, get in your hotel and just the guys, and that might benefit Florida a little bit.
Well, allegedly Game 4, they flew up all their family and friends all the way up to Edmonton for a potential celebration. What it sounds like from your experience is there's a chance that none of them are getting flown up, and it's like, hey, we got to get back to ball here. We got to get back to puck, fully focused, especially in somebody else's barn. But let's talk about that barn, especially with how Edmonton is playing now. That place can get wild, and you play 17 years thus far in the NHL. Is that notoriously, like, greatest home ice advantage? And if Connor McDavid gets one early, does any of that shit that he does early, that place is going to be on fire. Is that a real advantage up there in Edmonton? I mean, that's filthy. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I was watching the highlight with you. I mean, he's a special guy. I mean, that's a special talent. I think him and McKinnon this year, I'm biased to my boy Nate in Colorado, too, but I mean, those guys do special things that, you know, no one else can do, and you saw it right there. But, yeah, I mean, that team gets rolling in Edmonton. That place is buzzing. They're going to be buzzing right from the anthems. You know, you got, you know, the U.S. Star-Spangled Banner and O Canada going. It's going to be buzzing right from there. You know, and it's a Canadian hockey market. They love their Oilers, and, you know, they got all of Canada behind them watching. So it's going to be buzzing. It's going to be buzzing early. Florida, I'm sure, you know, they know it. They've been in that building a couple times now, and there'll be a barrage early, I'm sure. You know, you weather the storm and try and get the game to settle out a little bit. But, you know, Connor McDavid, he's feeling it. He's got, 8 points in two games now?
Yeah, that's the most. Yeah, that's the most in a two-game span in the Stanley Cup Finals history or whatever. He has 42 points this postseason, which obviously if he gets 5 more points, he'll pass or tie Wayne Gretzky, the great one. He has 3 40-plus point playoff performances. Obviously nobody else has that. He's Wayne Gretzky. He's the great one. But when you talk about McDavid, the conversation was, this guy's not scoring. This guy's not doing this. Now, he was having 3 assists a game in the national media conversation. If there was conversation, it's good that there is conversation, was like, is Connor McDavid going to show up or whatever? And he's literally banking pucks off of his teammate's sticks into the goal. And they're like, is he ever going to score a goal or whatever? And he's come alive. But they were talking about his legacy. If he was to lose this one, let alone get swept this one, and all of Canada is seemingly behind him. If he comes back from being down 3-0 to winning, how are they talking about Connor McDavid in the hockey world this upcoming offseason?
Yeah, I mean, he's already, a lot of people say he's the best player in the world. You know, like I said, I mean, I would bring up, this season, I think, he and Nathan MacKinnon were on another level, and have been for quite some time. But, I mean, yeah, coming back from 3-0 in the Stanley Cup Finals and doing what he's doing, it's incredible. I haven't seen that in, I don't know if anyone ever has seen a performance like that, if that's what happens and he continues on this pace. He'll get his first one, and a guy like him, he's not going to try to stop there, and all the great players do. I mean, you get one and you just want another one. It just makes you hungry for another one.
That's why, when you're chugging beers out of Lourdes.
Yeah.
And I guess they say Connor McDavid is just like all puck. Mm-hmm. He's just like the perfect person to, like, Scotty Scheffler almost, they talk about, like, how he is just so good at his sport, all puck all the time. He's got that beard pretty wild.
Mm-hmm.
He looks like a Bigfoot, right?
I mean, yeah, playoff beard.
He does look like, with the hair and a big skate up there. I mean, he is flying around. It's great for hockey that he is absolutely balling. Similar situation now. Tone has a question for you.
Yeah, Jack, when you won the cup with the Avalanche, you guys were up 2-0, not 3-0, but then up 3-1, I believe, on Tampa. And then game six, you went and won in Tampa. When you don't have the momentum going into that game six, kind of like the Panthers do now, and that flight from Colorado to Tampa, like, what is... like, do you still have the confidence, or, like, are we going to let this one slip away? How do you think the Panthers feel flying back up to Edmonton?
Yeah, also, Jack, real quick also, is momentum a real thing in the NHL? Because obviously Maurice has said a lot of stuff about momentum not really being a entire, storyline. Do players feel the same way about that?
Yeah, you know what? I think the playoffs, it's pretty unique. I think each series in particular has its own story, and then each game within the series kind of has its own story. I don't know if it's necessarily momentum or it's more adjustments. If you lose a couple and you kind of figure it out how to fix whatever the problem is or stop the bleeding, it can be viewed as momentum to the fans, but really a team's made an adjustment that is now working. And it's the small adjustments within a 7-game series that, can mean the difference between winning or losing and turning the tide in a series. And then it's on, the ball's on the other team's court. Can they make adjustments now to counteract? So to me, it's more the adjustments made, not necessarily the momentum. To go back to your original question, we had the opportunity in game five to win it at home, like I said, and there was a lot of hoopla going around, and we were almost to the point where we just wanted the game to be over to get to the celebration. So that flight to Tampa, everything calmed down, and it was kind of the best thing that could have happened was, like I said, hunkering down. The distractions were gone, and we were able to just play. We had a lot of confidence. Tampa was a phenomenal team, 2-time defending Stanley Cup champs. We felt like we were the better team. I think every team in the Stanley Cup Finals feels like they're the best team, but you got to truly believe it. We felt like we were the best team. If we play the best we can, there's nothing they could do. So getting there, we still felt great. Had team meal, just the guys, did what we had to do. The team was awesome. They flew up two guests, whoever you want, your wives, brother, your father, whatever, on them. My wife asked, should I come? And I go, absolutely. You got to be there. We knew this was happening. And, so like I said, in my particular situation, flight was great. We were confident. We were calm. We were cool. And getting there, being just the guys, was the best thing we could do.
Colorado and Tampa, what's that, probably 4 hours or whatever. Mm-hmm. They get double that amount of time.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, figure it out, heading all the way up to Edmonton. Yeah, hopefully the poker table gets them settled in. I know Darius is obviously hoping for that, but what else do they need to do?
Yeah, I'm nervous as shit right now, Jack, and I need you to kind of be a coach for me right now. Because in football, you got a great wide receiver, you can double team and kind of limit him, maybe not stop him. Basketball, double team a guy, get the ball out of his hands. What are the adjustments now? Obviously, Florida Panthers hang their hat on on their defense. What are the adjustments now with how the series is going, how the Oilers are playing? How can we slow down this freaking phenom, Connor?
Connor McDavid. Well, I mean, first of all, a guy that good, you're not going to stop him completely. He's going to get some chances. You know, obviously, you're trying to limit those chances. Yep. You don't want to let him blow up for 4 points a night. I mean, I remember, honestly, in our series against Edmonton a couple of years ago when we played him in the conference finals, we had a couple games where we walked away and we're like, hey, you know, I feel like we did a pretty good job, you know, keeping him down. You look at the score sheet and he had 3 points. And you're like, well, maybe we didn't. but no, I mean, like he's going to make things happen. He's just that type of player. One of the things that we really focused on was it's a lot easier to try and deprive a guy the puck than take it away from him. So if you have the puck, you can hold on to it in the offensive zone.
Smart.
You got to try to make them play defense so they're not just, you know, full of gas coming the other way to play offense on you. That was one thing we did. And there's obviously the old cliches of don't put them on the power play all the time. But, you know, that's a fine line because you can't be out there being like, well, we can't take a penalty. Because then, you know, now you're playing a little cautious and, you know, you're not pinning the ears back and going. So that's a fine line. But, you know, for us, like I said, he's still got his chances. Like I said, we thought we limited him. And we look at the score sheet and he'd have 2-3 points. But, you know, trying to make them play defense is probably the best way to keep them at bay a little bit.
Good work, lads. How about us, too?
Yeah.
Connor McDavid. What, McJesus, my ass.
Oh boy.
Three assists.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Next, yeah. That's pretty much how it went.
Yeah, guy can't play. Guy can't hold. Not against us. Maybe against everybody else. Then
yeah.
Stats person comes in. All right, this is what we did. Draisaitl had one. Pretty good. McDavid had three assists. And whoa.
Wait.
Okay. Did not understand that. Really? I assume that happens everywhere, though.
I will say we were pretty blessed with we matched up Nathan MacKinnon on Connor McDavid.
Yeah, you're pounding that drum. McKinnon's a guy, huh? But he's not in the playoffs right now.
Yeah, and Cale Makar was standing right behind him every shift. So, you know, you had two of the best skaters in the world going head to head, and then, you know, if he was coming down and he got on the other side, he had to get by Cale Makar, who in my opinion is the best defenseman on the planet.
Skating, I just heard you describe, obviously, MacKinnon and McDavid as two of the best skaters. Skating's the ultimate thing that Connor McDavid has over everybody else, because obviously I grew up in Pittsburgh. Sydney skating, like his quads obviously gigantic. He seemingly could just protect the puck with a flat-ass stick because of how he can skate and how he can move his body. Connor moves different than Sydney, though, and it sounds like MacKinnon does as well. Is skating the X factor that Connor McDavid has alongside everything else? Like, is that the big difference maker whenever you're scouting another team? Like, hey, this son of a bitch can move. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what happens in the NFL with Tyreek Hill. Like, hey, mm-hmm. this guy can move better than all mm-hmm. of us. Is that how it is in the NHL as well?
Yeah, for sure. I don't think it's any different than any other sport. I mean, speed kills, right? I mean, he's... That guy can fly, and it's not just his speed alone, it's his speed with the puck. He's so dynamic. He doesn't slow down when he gets it. And, you know, MacKinnon's the same way. I think they're just as dynamic, but I think they're slightly different. McDavid almost floats on top of the ice. Nate, when he skates, it's violent. It's like you can hear his skates digging into the ice. You know, they're a little bit different in terms of their style, but at the end of the day, their speed kills. It's incredible. It's tough to defend, you know, and the same thing with Cale. I think what makes Cale so incredible is his skating and his speed, you know, and they're able to do things with the puck at that speed.
The fact that you guys are doing all that shit on ice is wild.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah.
Like, I used to go to Open Skate $5 on Friday nights, yeah. And I guess I could get around, you know, and rented skates, and I could stop every once in a while. And I'll tell you what, you skate backwards, people think you're the real deal. Yeah. But if I had to actually operate, I would have no chance. I'm eating shit literally the entire time. These dudes are doing triple axles over other people while also dangling the stick and then dumping rubber at the same time. It's phenomenal. It's a wild sport. Got to get in it whenever you're young. And on the big storyline of this entire playoffs has been goalies standing on their heads. Who's next? Well, Ty has a question for you, Jack.
Yeah, Jack, it seemed like early in the playoffs, that was kind of the one knock on Edmonton. It was like, hey, they don't really have the top-end goaltending that a lot of these other teams have, and that's kind of going to be their Achilles heel. And really, since then, Stuart Skinner's kind of answered the bell at every step of the way. Is that something that both teams recognize, like going into the game on Friday night? Like, will Edmonton be like, hey, we can maybe be a little bit more aggressive and maybe take some more chances because of how well he's been playing? And then on the flip side, like Florida, are they like, hey, we need to have quality shots on net because this guy is playing so well? Like, is that something you immediately recognize when you get on the ice?
Well, I think it definitely instills confidence in your team and in your players. You know, like I said, you're in the Stanley Cup Finals. You're not going to limit them to no chances. But when you get confidence to know if there's a breakdown or you got a penalty kill and your goalie's dialed, you know, he's going to bail you out. I think that's a huge confidence thing to allow you to play a little bit more free and loose, make some plays. You know, at the end of the day, you got to make plays to win. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But you have to be willing to make some plays. You know, I think, you know, in terms of Florida, I mean, who knows, maybe Edmonton has made some adjustments in terms of where they're shooting and how they're shooting and, you know, all those things that you never know. That's for behind the scenes for them to tell you. But there's always some games with the goaltenders. I mean, that's a game within the game that you know, fortunately, I don't have to deal with the goalies. They're kind of on their own deal.
Yeah, smart, like kickers and punters. I get it.
End of that second period last night, like, Skinner, I mean, it had to be at least like 9-10 shots.
Yeah.
Like,
and then I saw time he was also, after a couple of those saves, whenever there was a, you know, a face-off or whatever, they had music playing. And he was like bobbing his head to the music. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, this guy.
Yeah, he's in it.
This
he's
guy is locked it. In right now. He is completely in the zone. And then you see his mustache. It's like, oh, this guy's a legend.
Moxie.
We got a great series. And we can't thank you enough for the great conversation. Stanley Cup champion, 17 years Woo. Thus far in the NHL. Jack Johnson. Thank you, buddy.
Yeah, Jack.